दिस इज़ माई थर्ड वीडियो ऑन द पोएम द पेट्रियट रिटन बाई रॉबर्ट ब्राउनिंग. इन माई प्रीवियस टू वीडियोज आई हैड गिवन लाइन बाई लाइन एक्सप्लेनेशन ऑफ द पोएम, द वेरियस स्टैंजाज ऑफ द पोएम. टूडे इन माई थर्ड वीडियो आई वुड बी डिस्कसिंग अबाउट द वेरियस अदर एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ द पोएम, सच एज द राइम स्कीम, द फिगर्स ऑफ स्पीच और द लिटररी डिवाइसेस, एज वी से द वेरियस थीम्स ऑफ द स्टोरी and the various kinds of imagery used in the poem. I would also be discussing about allusions, the various allusions we find, various symbols we find. Okay, so we would first begin by determining the rhyme scheme of the poem. To determine the rhyme scheme of the poem, we look at the last words in every line. See here, the last word of the first line is way, the last word of the second line is mad. So way and mad are not rhyming, so I call this A and I call this B. Now see the last word of the third line, sway. Sway is rhyming with way, so as both are rhyming, so I give the same alphabet A. Now see the last word of the fourth line, had. Had is rhyming with mad. So if this is B, this also has to be B. Now see the last word of the fifth line, it is day. Day is rhyming with way, sway, day. So if this is A, this is A, this also will be A. So now my rhyme scheme, it is A, B, A, B, A. Because five lines are there, so it is A, B, A, B, A. This is the rhyme scheme. Now coming to the various figures of speech. See, it was roses, roses all the way. Here roses are, roses stand for the love, the respect. So we find a comparison over here between the roses and the love, the respect, the admiration that the people had for the patriot. So the roses symbolize that. Roses here symbolize all that love, all that adulation. So here we find an implicit comparison. The comparison is not clear, it is implicit, it is understood. So here we find metaphor. Here the figure of speech is metaphor, because here roses stand for the love, the glory, the adulation, the respect that the people had for the patriot. So here the figure of speech is metaphor, because here there is a hidden comparison between roses and the love of the people. Second line, see, with martel mixed in my path like mad. Second line here, if you take a close look, we find the alphabet M repeated. M, martel, mixed and mad. So here we have the figure of speech called alliteration. What is alliteration? It is the repetition of an alphabet in the same line. So here in the same line, in the one line only, we find the alphabet M repeated thrice. So it is alliteration. Now if you come to the third line, the house roof seemed to heave and sway. Here see, heaving and swaying, it is a human activity. So here, but it is attributed to a non-living object like house. So it is an example of personification. What is personification? Attribution of human activity, human quality or human emotion to any inanimate or non-living object. So here heaving, human beings heave and sway. So but here what seems to be heaving and swaying? The house tops. So it is an example of personification where human emotion, human activity is attributed to a non-living object. Now come to the second stanza. See here the fourth line, but give me your son from yonder skies. This is an example of hyperbole. What is hyperbole? Hyperbole means exaggeration. Okay, so here the patriot had not actually asked for the sun, but here it refers to the dearest thing, the dearest object. So here he is exaggerating that here the patriot in a very exaggerated tone he is saying that if at that moment of glory, if he had asked for the people that give me your son, that also they would have readily accepted. So this is an example of hyperbole. He is not actually telling the people to leap at the son and give it to the patriot, but it only refers to giving away the dearest thing. Okay, so it is an example of hyperbole. It is also an example of metaphor. Why metaphor? Because sun here is compared. Sun actually refers to glory. Okay, glory, victory, triumph, something which is very dear to us. So here, sun is compared to glory, achievement, something great. So here we also find comparison and also hyperbole. Then in the third stanza, alack, it was I who leaped at the sun. Here we have allusion. Here mythological reference to the story of the famous Greek craftsman Daedalus and his son Icarus is made over here. What reference? In very ancient times, in Greek, in a place called Crete, you can say, there ruled a king called King Minos, and he was very proud. And what did King Minos do? He imprisoned the two master craftsmen, that is Daedalus and his son Icarus, and he imprisoned them in his own labyrinth. What is labyrinth? It is a maze, bhul-bhulaiya as we say. And he had imprisoned the father Daedalus and his son Icarus. And in order to escape from the imprisonment, what did Daedalus do? As he was a master craftsman, he collected the wings. He collected the feathers from the wings of birds. The feathers that had fallen and that were scattered. And he joined all those feathers with the help of wax. And he attached those wax to a wooden structure and made two pairs of wings, one for himself and one for his son Icarus. And they flew out from the king's imprisonment. But before flying, he warned his son Icarus that, see, these wings are attached to the wooden structure with the help of wax. So don't go very near to the sun, otherwise the wax will melt and you will drown into the sea. But Icarus, being young and ambitious and getting this new experience of flying, he forgot all about his father's warning and he went too near to the sun, and as a result the wax melted and he fell into the Aegean Sea and thus drowning himself. So here leaping at the sun means being too overconfident, be having too much of confidence in your capabilities, and in the end harming yourself. Okay, in that overconfidence. So here we get an allusion to the craftsman, master craftsman Daedalus, his son, and his son Icarus. The blunder that Icarus had done, the same blunder was committed by the patriot. He also forgot, he became overconfident of his capabilities, and ultimately so Icarus reached to a height and then fell down. So here the patriot also is in a similar condition. He also reached a great height of glory. Not that physical height, but the patriot also reached a great height of glory. And from there, he also plunged in that sea of hatred, you can say. Or he also met that same undignified end in the end, that same shameful end in the end. He was being executed. So just as Icarus, he also rose to a height, but then he was trampled down to dust also by the people. So here we get an allusion. Then here we don't have any figure of speech. In the fourth stanza, come to the fifth stanza. I go in the rain. Here we have a figure of speech called pathetic fallacy. What is pathetic fallacy? I go in the rain. Here rain again, something natural. And rain symbolizes the washing away of the disgust, the washing away of the glory, the disgust, the humiliation, you can say. So here we have pathetic fallacy, where human, natural, okay, attributing like human emotions, attributing human emotions to all aspects within nature. So here human emotion of undergoing all that pain, that shame, okay, that feeling of defeat, that has been attributed to rain. So here we have pathetic fallacy. Now sixth stanza, drop down dead. See this line, drop down dead. We can very clearly see the alphabet D repeated thrice in the same line. So it is an example of alliteration. Okay. So these are all figures of speech. Rhyme scheme is A, B, A, B, A. And what figures of speech do we find in this entire poem? We find metaphor, and we find alliteration, we find personification, we find allusion, we find pathetic fallacy. And here also we find alliteration. Now, see this line, with martel mixed in my path like mad. Okay, so here we have simile also, because like comparison is done over here. With the huge number of flowers compared to the frenzied state of the people. So we have simile also over here. Now see, there are various symbols also in this poem. First, roses. Roses symbolize the welcome, of the welcoming of the patriot with respect, honor and passion. Here martel again symbolizes purity, love, innocence and generosity. Now here, church spires again are towers. So they symbolize the height of glory. They symbolize hope. They symbolize strength. Sun symbolizes, it is a symbol of something unreachable or beyond access. Okay. So these are the figures of speech. Now coming to the various themes in the poem. The first theme in the poem is that of fickle-mindedness of the people. So see, the people described in the poem, they are fickle-minded because they are not constant in their opinion about the patriot. Just a year ago, they had hailed him as a hero, praised him, worshipped him as a demigod. But just after a year, within a year, span of 1 year, you can say, how they trampled, how they brought down the patriot from that great height of glory to that of dust. So where people were not constant in their opinion, how public opinion changes so fast. So first theme of the poem is fickle-mindedness of the people. Second is rise and fall of glory. So nothing is permanent in this world. You rise to a great height of glory and then you are bound to fall. Okay, at some point in your life, because it is all transitory, nothing is permanent. So rise and fall to glory, also they are like ups and downs, one follows the other, and nothing is permanent. So as we observe this in the case of the patriot, how he rose to glory and again he made his downfall also. Third theme is to have faith in God. Whatever happens, ultimately God is the ultimate judge and God's judgment can never be wrong. So to have faith in God's judgment. This is what is Browning, it was Browning's philosophy also, and the same philosophy is revealed in the poem The Patriot. The patriot doesn't blame his countrymen, although he feels regretful, he feels sorrowful, but he doesn't blame them. Okay? And he gets solace in the fact, he resigns to his fate, he gets solace in the fact that although he has been misjudged, his actions have been misunderstood by his own people in this mortal world, definitely when he goes near to God, when he is in the nearness of God, God will pay him accordingly. God is going to judge him in the as he deserves. So whatever he owed actually and which was not given to him in this mortal world will be given to him by God. So he has a deep faith in God's judgment. Fourth theme is that of betrayal. So the patriot tried to do even the impossible task for his town people. And in return, what did they do? They stamped him as a criminal and executed him. So thus they betrayed him. They forgot within a span of 1 year, they forgot that it was he only who had given them that son, who had brought victory to them. But and what do? They bring him down. They forget. And they misunderstand his actions, his deeds. And so his deeds now become misdeeds. And that too in a span of 1 year. So theme of betrayal is also there. Then we also, the fifth theme is that of the spirit of optimism. Definitely, yes, the poem ends on a note of optimism. That without considering what would be the end result of our actions, we must keep on doing good deeds for our near and dear ones, for our countrymen, for our people, irrespective of what we get in the end. So the poem definitely has a ends on a spirit of optimism. Who is feeling optimistic? The poet is feeling optimistic. The patriot is feeling optimistic that when he reaches God, definitely he is going to be paid. He is going to be blessed. He is going to get his due, what he did not get in this mortal world. That is his due, which he owed, is going to be given to him by God. So the poem also has a spirit of optimism. Thank you. I hope that all my three videos, with the help of my three videos, I would have definitely been able to clear all your doubts regarding the poem The Patriot. Thank you.